grandfather's grandfather was an enslaved African. My grandfather was a pastor, and my grandmother was a seamstress. On my mother's side, my grandfather picked up bottles for a living and would sell it to supermarkets or anybody that would accept the bottles, and that was his means of income as a single father to raise my mother and her three brothers. The income you would earn from that would be way beyond minimum wage, so for me, it's a miracle that he was able to do what he did. And at about mid-teenage years, my mother moved with my grandmother, and she sold fruits in Jamaica's very rough downtown district. So those are the shoulders upon which I stood and still stand, and their objective in their time was to ensure that my parents and their siblings survived. And I promise you that was a most ambitious goal at the time in which they found themselves. So we fast forward, I come into the picture, and as I was growing up, I always wanted to be an astronaut. It was through my veins, it was all I could think about, and my parents made me feel it was absolutely possible. Bless them. It reminds me of inspirational stories I hear about people who are disabled, whose parents never told them they were disabled, whose parents never told them they wouldn't be able to do X or Y or Z because of whatever it was they were facing. What ends up happening in those situations? They do everything we do. They drive, they cut tomatoes with their toes, they do whatever needs to happen for them to accomplish their goals. And so given that my parents made me feel this was absolutely possible, as I grew, I continued to grasp and hold on to this desire. My parents, whenever they heard about astronauts, would tell me about it, and MIT kept on coming up. And I thought to myself, oh my gosh, this is excellent. One of my personal traits is that I feel nothing is worth doing if it's not done well. And so MIT was coming up as the world's number one engineering university. And I said, okay, that's exactly where I want to go. The only thing is, MIT accepts 2.3% of non-North American citizens who apply. And there was an unwritten rule back in 1997 when I applied that only one person per year gets into MIT from Jamaica. No pressure, right? And so I threw my hat in the ring. But I want to share with you a big part of why I did so. I had so many people who encouraged me, but they never went to MIT. They never went into, they never even applied. But I remember when I was in grade 10, I had a teacher who was in his gap year, and he applied to MIT. And bless him, but he could not spell to save his life. And when he was going through the process, he lifted as he climbed, and when he got in, it hit me. Oh, so you don't have to be perfect. He's Jamaican just like me, and he got in. So that really, really inspired me to apply. At the time I was applying, there was a pair of twins who also applied, and that made me so stressed out because, I mean, admit it, how cute is it to be a twin? Like, you can just say that, and that should really carry you far away, right? But as life would have it, I was successful, and I was also successful as the only person to get into Princeton University at the time I applied. And I share this because I feel that when my grandfather's grandfather was cutting cane along with possible other ancestors in the cane fields of Jamaica, and the back-breaking sun was upon him, he would look up into the sun and dream of me. And he persevered because of me. And I feel like I am his hopes and dreams personified. And that is why I continue to push. If he could have accomplished what he did, then I feel there's nothing I can't do. And so those are some of the things that make me tick. One of the most pivotal inflection points I've had in my life was the opportunity to travel to Ghana when I was 17. And we traveled to the Cape Coast Fort. And I'm not sure, has anyone here ever been to the Cape Coast Fort? Okay, I have one person to my right. And we entered this fort where they would hold enslaved Africans for up to maybe 4 months or so before they would leave on the ships of no return to countries like Jamaica. The room is about the size of this auditorium with two windows, I remember, no bigger than 6 inches by 6 inches. And once I stepped into the room, there was still a line on the wall, maybe about, let's say, a meter and a half horizontally where excrement came to, and I just want to keep it real with you, right? There was still a scent I could smell nearly 200 years after my grandfather's grandfather's grandfather would have been in the room. And I said to myself, what tragedy must it have been for someone to have to stand there, remain there for 4 months amidst excrement? You don't get a seat, you don't get a bed. And so when I reflect on things like that, I'm so inspired to be not only the best I can be, but to lift everybody else up as they seek to climb to fully self-actualize. So with experiences like that in my knapsack, once I got to MIT for the first time, I was tested. I come from a country that already has had someone looking like me as a prime minister, but no, I was a whole different face. I was the only black person in the aerospace class of 2002 for undergrad and for grad school, and I will remember it was August 16, 1998, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, heading off to school. I didn't own any sweaters, so I stopped in New York first to buy my first sweater because Boston is a little colder than Jamaica, and the customs officer held back our bags as Jamaicans. My mother and I were traveling. If you're Jamaican, you're more than likely a drug dealer. That was the story then, that's the stereotype then, and it's still a stereotype now. So he was going through our bags looking very excited, like he knew he was going to find the cocaine, and then he'd be able to retire and perhaps live in Jamaica for the rest of his life. In looking through my bag, of course, no cocaine was found, but he found my orientation booklet for MIT. I promise you, all the blood shifted from his face. He looked like he had seen a ghost. And he said, you applied to MIT? You're gonna go, you know, it's really hard, you know, why didn't you apply to a state school in New York? It wasn't a rhetorical question. It was as if DNA tests had been done, which confirmed that the black brain could not hold up to any standard that MIT would hold, and he wanted to save me the embarrassment before going off up north to Boston. And in that moment, I was very thankful that I grew up in the setting I grew up in, but I also made a personal commitment to myself to ensure that I succeeded, because as the only Jamaican in my year going, I felt like an ambassador, not only for Jamaicans right now, but for people like my grandfather's grandfather. And so getting there, things of that nature would continue. I'll give you one more example. 6 years into my tenure, I was walking one day along the corridor, and a member of the janitorial staff thanked me for picking up the bag yesterday. And I said to her, I'm not so sure what you're talking about. She said, you're the new janitor, right? And you picked up the garbage bag from the room, thank you. And I said, no, I'm a student here. I go to school here. And she looked at me like, oh my gosh, she only started working one day now, and she's already hallucinating that she's a student. And so, you know, those things really serve to drive me. And as I continue with my tenure, I learned that astronauts have their area of expertise and they contribute that expertise to missions. And so I committed to finding my area of expertise, which for me was how aerospace technology, like satellite communication technologies, can exist in a symbiotic relationship with other ICTs to bring access to basic human rights for those who suffer the most. And I have a consulting practice where I do that now, and I have continued to seek to reach the unreachable. I think that our reach must always exceed our grasp so that we have to come out of our comfort zone to achieve that which we want. Along those lines, even in coming to Wsis, I was so inspired about being able to come last year that I wanted to come back. I know that this is a mecca for anyone interested in ICT for development. And the budget would have been about $4,500 to come here from Jamaica. I didn't have $5 of that, but I set about to crowdfund my being here. Did I get many more no's than yeses? Did I hinge on the line of not having enough time to apply for my Schengen visa? Did I apply for it in faith before getting all the money? Absolutely yes. But thankfully it worked out, because I think about the things that my ancestors went through and that this pales in comparison. Similarly, you'd have learned, I learned to swim at 36. I decided I was going to be a triathlete. And the Lord swam with me in open water as I did my first triathlon in 2017, but it happened. And it's just an example of being your best self. I'll leave you with a quote or an understanding of how the lobster grows. The lobster, as you know, has a very hard shell. And when he's growing, he gets to a point where the size of his shell becomes very, very, very uncomfortable. He then goes under maybe a larger sea creature or anything he can find, and he releases that shell, and then he gets a bigger shell. In order for us to grow, ladies and gentlemen, we must exist on the fringes and outside our comfort zones. But we must also encourage others to do so. That man who taught me when I was in grade 10 didn't spend 50 cents in his inspiration of me, but he made me dare to dream the, in my mind, inconceivable 2.3%. And so I want us to encourage ourselves to always be that lobster. Always be willing to be uncomfortable. If you're trying for something and it doesn't seem unachievable when you first start, you're not dreaming big enough. Make sure that your dreams scare you and reach for them and encourage others to always do the same. I thank you as we all enrich our inner lobsters. Cheers.